Hello and welcome aboard, pool fans. We have more coverage from the Ultimate 10 Ball Championship. My name is Mark Wilson, and alongside me, providing insights and analysis, is Jeff Conway. Jeff, Phil Burford, Darren Appleton before us. This figures to be a great one.
Yes, you've got two Englishmen here. Appleton, multi-time world champion. Phil was junior world champion in 08 in WPA and also runner-up in 09. So they played four times and the score is 2-2. So I think everyone will be more recognising Appleton than Phil, but Phil was over here for 6 months last year and a lot of people got to know how he played and a great player. So I think this is a bit of a coin flip and we'll see how this one goes.
Race to 10 ball. Darren Appleton also has won a couple U.S. Open 9-ball championships.
Correct.
Been a huge luminary on the world scene here for the last 5 years.
He's from Pontefract in Yorkshire, and not far from where Phil lives, which is Darlington in Co-Durham.
Burford's won the lag and the right to break. We're playing all ball fouls and call shot 10 ball. 10 ball does not count on the break.
And the key to this game, make balls on the break. It looks like it's going to be dry. And got a little nudge from the diamond
magic rack.
Yeah.
Well, that's the detriment to it. It does interfere with the balls once in a while, but it racks the balls great. So there's always a trade-off.
Always good to get the first one on the first bead on the wire.
Yeah, it's the second toughest game to get. The last game's the toughest. The first one's second toughest.
Well, the good news is they're in the winner's bracket, so even if someone, one of these players gets beat, can still come back from the other side.
Very smooth opening stroke there.
Didn't really want to be on the rail, though.
To get to this juncture of the tournament, Appleton has beaten Eric Durbin and Mike Davis. Phil Burford got here by virtue of the fact that he beat Johnny Mora, who's playing great, and Mark Vidal Claremont.
In both matches, he was way ahead, and they almost caught him up, but they got closer than he would have liked before he could just get that last game. He was 9-4 up on both his players and ended up 9-6 and 9-7.
Appleton moving easily through this rack of balls.
Yeah, I think this is going to be a similar sight here. When either player gets to the table and the balls are spread out there, they'll be running them out, no question. Everything's sitting pretty here.
This is day three of the Ultimate 10 Ball Championship. Great event, classy venue, tremendous equipment, great players, great prize money.
Nice dress code, which is a pretty sight to see, I must admit, compared to a lot of tournaments. Well, he just wants to make sure he's the right side of the 7 here to get on the 8, but it's a pretty easy run out here.
Just rolling the ball, using ball speed to gain position.
I remember seeing him years ago when he first came over, and he was at the Turning Stone Tournament of upstate New York, and they threw the balls on the table and they were really close together in the middle of the table. And I watched him pick his way through the rack and I said, oh my God, this guy's good. And that was probably one of the first times I saw him play. That was way back, probably 6 years ago, 7 years ago. Background is 8-ball in England on small tables. He was an accomplished amateur boxer that actually picked between boxing and professional pool, and he decided to play pool. Probably managed to keep his pretty looks by picking the route for pool.
Rather than boxing, which is what he was known for, right?
Yeah. Still a useful background. So we have the first bead on the wire to Darren Appleton. 38. I think he's 38 years old. 38 years old.
And how old is Phil?
Phil is 22, comes from Darlington, Co-Durham. That's near Newcastle, which might locate it better for any Americans listening. So it's way up on the left-hand side, almost into Scotland. As I said, he was junior world champion in 08 and second in the 2009 world championship.
Appleton crushed the rack, squared up the cue ball in the center of the table, got kissed way down to the corner pocket for a foul. Pretty unfortunate occurrence, but good break for Phil.
And this is spread out nicely here. So
these guys all train like athletes, and you can look at their fitness level as they walk around the table. You can see it's not something that they do while they smoke a pack of cigarettes and eat two chili dogs every day, drink a few beers or anything. This is actually a athletic.
Phil is a keep fit nut. He's in the gym all the time, training for a biathlon, or like a Ironman, where they do the cycling, swimming, and running. Goes running every day, 7 miles.
Well, I'm also in training, Jeff. I don't know if you know that. It's Phil bumped into the sixth ball.
Yeah.
Hit the wrong side of it.
Yeah.
Training for an eating contest coming up.
Yeah. The seafood contest. Every time you see food, you eat it. Yeah, I know. Well, he ruined a good run out there. I think he could get enough to bank this, but he's probably going to play safe.
What happened here was he did not play a good shot with ball in hand and picked up the wrong angle on the tee ball. Had to go to the end rail, and then so doing slightly mishit the cue ball and chipped the sixth ball. So,
and he uses the Stan Shuffit center to edge system for his accuracy on shot making. That's why he doesn't miss too many shots. Hi, Stan, if you're out there.
Beautiful shot there. Clipped the point, however, to get a little fortune.
And got nicely on that four, you noticed, pretty well where he was pointing, where he wanted to put it.
Yep. He certainly didn't want to play it off the point. Appleton takes a hard swallow there. That's not pleasant. A little bit of good fortune.
Back on track. That was a great shot. Because these rails alter during the week, and with the lights on, these play different than the ones out in the main arena. Slow down. You might be able to make that, but that's sloppy.
No, he can't make this. This would be two cushions in this. Well, maybe he can. Maybe. Boy, it'd be. That cue ball's gonna be good and hot.
I think
if he does.
Maybe got like half a ball between it, maybe.
Okay, yeah, then you're probably right.
But it's gonna be sending the cue ball across a few times. That's what he's looking at.
We're kind of seeing some opening rack jitters here. He did not do well with ball in hand, and now he had a pretty straightforward layout. Overdrew it.
He can make this almost dead straight in. He's gonna like draw down on this. No, he's gonna follow it off the side rail. No. May hook him behind the eight, no.
So realistically, in this opening frame, I would have to say that there was three modest errors that finally contributed to his demise.
Yeah, absolutely. That rack was an accident waiting to happen. Especially when you think he had ball in hand, Mark.
Yeah, and a wide open layout. But it goes to show you how ball in hand is not as simple as people think. You really need to do something productive with that. And you should get three balls pretty routinely if I give you the first one ball in hand.
Well, now he's at the 50-yard line here. It's makeable, but not really what he wanted.
Well, Appleton is a tenacious ball pocketer. And so as he gets out of line, it seems like he bears down harder, surprisingly, once in a while.
He hasn't won about four world championships for nothing. And two U.S. Opens.
I always describe him as this. If I was ever in a combat situation, I'd want Darren Appleton in my foxhole because he's just that kind of a fighter.
Well, Phil's going to be kicking himself at the end of this rack because he certainly had the chance to go 1-1, and now he's finding himself behind 2-zip.
Beautiful shot there. Appleton takes full advantage.
Alternate break here, so that's an advantage to both players. It keeps technically keeps the score closer. Not always the case.
Pretty nice prize money here, isn't there?
Yeah,
pays the field pretty deep. Like up till 32nd place, I believe, gets a pretty good payday out of this. So
yeah,
we really have to credit Body Nazat, the benefactor, kind benefactor out of his pocket. There's no sponsorship money. This guy chooses to do it for the love of the sport. Puts on the free stream.
I think a lot of people find that hard to believe, but they got to look at the numbers, and that's what he's doing.
Well, even the free streaming, I mean, that's remarkable by itself. You never hardly see that. If you do see it, it's not a quality stream. All for the love of the sport. And so,
well, he has a plan, and he's making it happen, so it's good to see.
And commensurately, he deserves all the support that we can throw his way for anyone out there in the pool world.
Well, his aim is to run 10 tournaments like this a year in different parts of the world, and judging by this one and his previous ones, they've all been a success, but they get better every time, and this one's pretty cool. So.
Man, we always say it, but beautiful venue here. 26 tables, brand new diamond tables, diamond lights, great balls, referees.
Key shot here.
Very well done.
Yeah. Because even though he made some balls on the break, he didn't necessarily have the best shot to start with. It's usually the hardest shot, the first one.
Phil wisely decides not to give up on the magic rack removal. Bring the referee out here because he's liable to commit an object ball foul in so removing that. So I would not take that chance myself either. There's no point. This is going to be tough, though, Jeff, to get that magic rack off the table. I mean, you almost need a scalpel to disassemble it to assure yourself of not hitting one of those balls. The referee's going to mark some balls, it appears.
So it's not so magic sometimes. I think the referee's milking his TB time here.
Might as well get a call out there performing a magic rackectomy.
I don't think he should have held that card up that said, "Hi, Mum."
Well, the three ball is pretty tricky. Frozen to the cushion right near the side pocket, so good position is very necessary here.
Yeah, just run it down.
Made it look easy.
Well, the good players do that. That's the problem.
Got to go by past the point here. These are fairly narrow pockets, too. No problem for the likes of Phil Verford. You know, he's really smoothed out here in the second rack.
And he's got to get back into this. Alternate break. It's not that easy to get back in it if you're all running racks, which sometimes happens. Thank you. He's going to draw this back a little. Play the seven downtown. No, side pocket.
Does Phil also have a snooker background?
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. I was down at the Johnny Archer Classic, where I took Warren Kiamko down there, and Phil, and the Richard Sweet Memorial, that Phil won. Beat Johnny 9-0 in the final. Just throw that in. And they had a snooker table over in the corner of the room. And in between his matches, he come back to me and he said, I've just been playing a little bit of snooker. I said, oh, really? He said, yeah, I haven't played for 5 years. He said, I played with my pool stick. He said, I just ran 115.
Oh, wow. Yeah.
So, yes, he has a snooker background.
Beat Johnny Archer 9-0.
Yeah, in the final.
Okay, Burford claws a rack back, trails in the match, 2-1.
Darren Appleton first came over to the US probably in about 2005, 2006 on a gambling spree in New York, and suddenly got caught by the fact that everybody wanted big spots, and the only way he could get a match was to give too much away, and he also gave a lot of money away. But he learned a lot from that trip. Darren Appleton leading 2-1.
Well, didn't hit the rack quite as good the second time, but the first time he did it, he hit it perfect and got kissed into a scratch.
The only problem here is left Phil straight in, got a little tad of an angle on the one. But the two's on the side rail. I think it goes by the nine there.
No, does not.
No, tight.
Yeah. Going to do something different with the two ball, and that makes playing the one ball really of very little value. The one ball's far enough from the cushion and the pocket that rail first is not an easy option.
No, absolutely not.
It is an option.
And that probably wouldn't help him getting on the two, because he'd probably be coming back up here by the six somewhere off two rails.
Right, yeah, but kind of a shot to nothing. You can lose with it, but you can't win with it, so... These guys do not much care for playing those type shots.
A lot of balls up this. They've got the three and the five tucked together.
I think he should just thin the one ball and put it on the end rail down there. Let the cue ball run back down the table.
Mm-hmm. Soon find out.
He that's tried to pocket shot. It.
Might get away with this behind the six.
Going to
there
tell
it
you.
Goes.
This is unlike a snooker player, but he did wiggle his body on the stroke delivery, and because he felt this, the shot was distasteful, and it kind of broke his technique a little bit there.
Yeah, showed on his body language there.
Yeah, before and after the shot.
I think Darren can cut this in the side. But he's going to be crashing into the eight, probably.
Going to draw to the end rail. Trying to spin it over here. If he
don't scratch.
No. Yeah, nice shot there. Got a combination on the nine. The problem is the two ball's heading the wrong way for easy position.
He'd like to cut it fine enough that he could slide it between the two and the three and come up here somewhere and put the two behind the nine, but I don't think he wants to try that. If it's a little thick, he's going to hit the three. And even if that two goes past the nine, which it looks tight, it's so tight that I don't think he'd want to try this.
Safety.
That's not so good.
No.
Yeah, banged his cue into the ground there, so that said everything. because you don't get that many opportunities, you know. You go to the table, and if you make a bad shot, the other guy usually run out, so that's why you're kicking yourself.
Well, it looks like Phil has a cut shot, thin cut shot on the two, or he can play safe. He appears to be queuing up the safe. Oh, good job there, as he snugs the cue ball right up on the nine.
That's the key with these top players, is they don't just put it on the ball. They put it like touching the ball, and that's so key. But I think he can still come off that side rail, ain't it? Would have liked it a little further around on it, on the nine.
This is a call shot game, so he has to call a ball if he expects to get credit for it.
Yeah.
If you're just playing safe, you don't have to.
And if he hooks him, the other player can give it back to him. So.
And what Jeff's trying to say is if he hooks him and accidentally or inadvertently pockets another ball, you don't continue your inning unless the other player that would be the incoming player has an option and puts you back in.
Right. Yeah, it's a fair system. Because very often they usually, you know, they play a shot and know they can make the one in the side and the 10 downtown at the same time. But in this, you've got to call one or the other. Can't be hedging your bets.
Appleton called the two ball or the nine ball. I guess it was the 10 ball, I see. It's not a bad idea.
Wow, he got out of that smelling of roses.
Yeah, that couldn't have turned out any better.
And the rose is the national emblem of Yorkshire, the rose. So smelling of roses is good for a Yorkshireman, I guess.
Yeah, Phil's looking to see if there's a sliver of the two ball sticking out where he could hit it.
Well, if you can get enough left English on it, you can certainly get across it. You'd like to just kiss the side of the two coming off the cushion and go back across by the eight.
You know, I've had just a little bit of interaction with Phil, but he's such a pleasant young man, you know, with a cheerful demeanor, got a nice sense of humor about him.
He's a bright kid as well, very sharp kid.
Kind of the new face of pool.
Yeah, he's going to school at the moment. He's going to college in Darlington, where he lives. And when he's finished this year, he's going to do 3 years at university. So, but he's still going to carry on his pool career in conjunction with it.
Had to try a very difficult shot there.
Did he get away with it?
Well, he's left the cue ball close to the two, so while it might not easily go in, Darren will have a real comfortable time playing safe.
Yeah, could hide the one, could hide the cue ball behind the seven here.
Needs to get a rail. Did not.
Well, he's not happy with that one.
No, didn't get a rail.
There's going to be some dents in the floor over by his chair. And Phil would love to win this one, get it back to 2-2.
Yeah, Phil seems to be like the chronic overachiever in life. You know, he's training for triathlons and plays world-class pool, heading to school.
Well, right now, he's number two in the UK, behind Mark Gray. Another Mark, of course.
Here's a combination on the 10 ball with the safety easily at hand. Just a stop shot. Let the two ball come down table.
Oh,
didn't do great. Yeah, you can hear him sigh.
That's the one shot I'm always surprised that the pros, as good as they are, never seem to make combos. The amateurs got more chance of making a combo. I'm serious. I'm amazed that they don't make these combos. They look fairly easy, and they miss them by, you know, half a diamond.
Well, that was not an easy shot, but I think you attest by even saying that when you see great ball pocketers such as Burford and Appleton miss a combination, that's more testimony to how difficult that shot is.
Right.
But he primarily took it on because he thought for sure he was getting safe, and he just didn't get the cue ball back another inch or so, or he would have been totally safe.
And Darren can't believe he's back at the table. I'm assuming you can get a full shot of this. He might not like this.
Ball speed askew.
Yeah.
Well, now he's going to have to try to kick and play safe here.
Doesn't want to be jumping because it's too near to the eight. That's a difficult jump. He jumps real good.
Expecting to call something here if he didn't go with any pace whatsoever, just on the off probably chance he would make it.
Probably like to tuck the three off the cushion behind the four. Like that.
That's a pretty shot.
Yeah.
Yeah, very wise, educated, slow rolling kick safety.
Now Phil can do the same, but he hasn't got the balls to hide behind.
Well, he should come towards us, down to this end of the table where the magic rack is laying, and go two cushions. Same type of speed. Would like the cue ball to contact the second cushion well before the side pocket so he can just clip the three. That's not the preferred path. The direction he's taking is really not the optimum way to go at this one. Oh, he's calling it.
Yeah, and if you miss it, you're going to leave it in the pocket, probably. So
yeah,
probably wants to hit this hard enough that he doesn't leave it in the pocket.
Well, he's going to sell out from here. This is not a good way to go. He did make solid enough contact. Yeah,
that was not so good. Scratch.
Just a little bit of pool and experience there.
And when you look back, Mark, at the end of the when you look at the score at the end of the day, that this one game you might be giving him here is key.
Yeah, right. The early racks count just as much as the latter racks. You know, the latter racks are more memorable because that's when the score is getting down to crunch time. But
and all that came from a great save from Appleton there.
It did, right.
And it was a great shot because he had to hit that ball perfect to put the three where he put it. You know what I mean?
Like I certainly do. He made it look so easy and effortless, but that's world-class pool that to even have the judgment and the capacity to execute that type shot.
Did you say effortless or effortless?
Absolutely. Either way. Efren certainly pioneered those type tactics.
Still playing good, even though he's on the loser's side, but he played great against Alex last night, 9-8 before Alex took him down 10-8.
Right.
And only one game behind, and Alex is such a great player that losing to Alex one game is pretty cool.
Well, Efren was three games in front at one point.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Played awesome.
I was watching so many players, I didn't know what the score was in the middle. So
there was, you know, when you play a race to 10 ball on championship tables with tight pockets, and you can look back and say, you know what, he made about three or four errors throughout the entire match. That's really saying something,
right?
Because an amateur can make three or four errors in one rack, let alone 18 racks.
No, he's playing very good. We know he plays good one pocket and the other game banks, but he still has it, no question.
Nice stun across the table there. Appleton, never the tenacious ball pocketer, as we were already alluded to. Nothing but the heart of the pocket with a nine. Doesn't wipe its feet on the way in, so to speak. Very cleanly pocketed. And this 10 ball to take a 3-1 lead for Darren Appleton.
Race to 10. So Mr. Burford wants to get his act together here.
Let's talk about the Conway stable a little bit here. You know, there's the Lucas stables known in the horse racing industry, and then there's the Conway stables here in the pool industry.
Well, the Conway stable is like a hole in the water you pour money into, as the boat people say. Right now, I've got in this event, I've got young Phil Burford. So obviously in the commentary, I'm sure it comes across that I'm very unbiased. I try to keep it that way, but hope I don't say too much about him. Jason Shaw from Scotland, another great young player who's taken the US by storms, won pretty well every event I've put him in. And I've got Francisco Bustamante with me in many events till the end of the year. And in the 10 ball in the Southern Classic next week, I've got Niels Fayen. So I've got four players in the 10 ball Bigfoot tournament. And of course, no my luck, they'll probably play each other in the first round.
Well, it's quite a gene pool of talent, though, that you possess.
Yeah.
It's not like you just took anybody in, I guess.
Well, maybe it's years and years of getting to the point where I get the better players, you know. But I started off, you know, back in like 03 with Joey Korsiak on Long Island, who's a great player, not just local player. And I took him under my wing, got him some press releases and got some stuff out there about him, and put him on a Joss event the next weekend, and he won his first Joss event up in New York. And but then it was a little later I suddenly realised, you know, do I have to be backing these lesser players? Couldn't I back these top players? And of course, finding him is you've got to be in the business and get to know who's what, who's doing what. But I was sitting having dinner with Ralph Souquet, and I said to him, you know, do you ever need backers? And he said, yeah, you know, I've lost a few backers at the moment. I could do, you know, not backers, sponsors. And I put him in the US Open in 08, which I thought he was going to win. And Mika came back from the loser's side. I could have killed Mika that year. And that was the start of really backing the better players. It suddenly dawned on me that they all need help. And so obviously you want to help the better players.
Sure, right.
So that's a short synopsis of what happened.
And isn't there more pride, too? I mean, I think you're very proud to be associated with the top talent in the sport.
Oh, absolutely.
Nice shot there. Great deal of distance.
Yeah. It's amazing how they do that. They make it look so easy. They go like three rails and get the speed down perfect. He's on the cushion as well, so it's not like he can swerve this to get at the one, you know what I mean?
Right, and that's often more difficult than pocketing a ball. Sometimes a pocketing a shot has more margin of error than we're doing this, so it's deceptively difficult.
And it goes past the seven. It actually does go down the side rail, and if he could just miss the seven, but he's going to have to come from the bottom at this. No, he must be able to see the side of it, Mark. No, he'd like a big enough bounce to get behind the... Yes? How about that?
Beautiful shot. I want to applaud from up here for how good that was. Very nice.
Mr. Appleton's smiling. I'm not sure whether he's saying, well done, or lucky guy.
Well, I don't think lucky guy, because I think he appreciates that there was a percentage of the time it's going to end up here. He made a very nice hit, and certainly Daz, as he's known.
Yeah, tour. That's funny because we got Daryl Peach, who's known as the Dazzler, and Darren Appleton, known as Daz. So I think they should have a playoff
for who gets the title.
The Hitman. You got Raj Rundell and Torsten Homan, both called the Hitman. And many, many years ago, they actually got talking to each other and said, you know, I'm the Hitman. And you can imagine Raj, you know, like, I'm the Hitman, you know. And they were going to have a playoff for it. They were going to play a match to see who was going to be the ultimate hitman. And it fizzled out, so we've got two hitmen.
What a hit. What a nice hit.
Look at this lead.
Yep. I am rewarded. Pays to hit him. Once again, you better have expert cumanship to be able to hit the vertical axis of the cue ball, so it does bank nicely, so you can learn to judge it. Judgment is sharpened by a repeating swing.
And unfortunately, I don't think there's enough room between the 7 and the 1. He can't come off the cushion and cut it back into the corner pocket. So, oh, that's a lovely shot.
Nice exchange of safeties here. Each one has been very well thought out and executed.
And again, he put it right behind the ball. It's probably not touching. We can't see from here, but there's probably a little gap there. But he's coming off a side cushion.
Appleton wants to hit the lower portion of the one
and
ball.
And put it right back where it is, over by that. And that's how great these players are.
Yep, that's just plenty to hit it.
Come off the bottom of the one, thin, and try and put it back behind the seven. Oh, we went the other way. Oops, doesn't like that.
So there's a good reward for a series of nice safeties.
Another hole in the carpet. Bang.
No. Really, no fault of Appleton's. He played the shot the best he could. Wasn't like it was a tactical error or an execution error. No. It's just that tough of a shot.
I'd like to give a shout out to any of you guys down at 150 and out in North Carolina in Mooresville. If you'll have to be watching, hope you're enjoying the match and other matches. Watching this live stream free. Say hi to Nancy if you're listening. Mike Lacefield, if you're out there, I'm sure you all you do is watch TV and watch pool, so I'm sure you're not working today.
You've kind of become the Brian Epstein of pool, haven't you? That was Brian Epstein was the Beatles' original manager. Yeah, look at you. You got the talent.
Yeah, but he also died very young, so don't put me in the same category.
The Fab Four right here.
Well, I told my two guys yesterday, the young guns, I said, you're the best of the best. That's what I said. Because they look pretty smart in there.
Yeah.
Grey outfits.
You would think both of these players would own their own personal waistcoats from competing in England, because that's the way competition's held over there, right?
Yeah. Well, Phil brought his with him. Jason, we had to buy one for Jason. And I had to go out and buy one for Busty because he left his in the Philippines and forgot to bring it. So part of my budget included two new shirts. Ephraim hadn't got a vest either, so I had to buy Ephraim a vest. And he went to pay me yesterday, and I just said, no, keep the money. It's fine. It's on me. So at some time when he's in some major tournament, I'm going to go in and take the vest off him during the match.
Repossess it if he's playing Phil in the finals, huh?
Hey,
nice out there.
Got back in it a little there.
Yeah, he really earned that with a nice series of safeties and responses to safeties played back. It was not just one of those fast, flamboyant games. It was a very well played game.
So Darren would have been better to come off that lower part of the one. I think there wasn't that far out on the shot, so he was trying to come off the top of the ball and send the cue ball uptown. Behind the balls.
Well, I don't think he was. I think he was trying to come off the lower part of it. Was that awkward of an angle? That was. It was because it was pretty far from the rail too. You know.
And well, they're pinging. These rails ping a little and get sort of worse during the event. And with the lights over the table here, you get a faster speed and different reaction on the rails.
I don't think worse is the best word because it just changes as the evolution of the cloth breaks in. Because when we say worse, it maybe indicates the equipment is subpar.
Couldn't have better equipment than these diamond tables.
Look at this good break. Oh, boy.
You would like that not to have gone past the side pocket. That would have about sat in front of it. Made two balls on the break. Jesse Engel made six balls on the break in his 9 o'clock match. Still lost, but
this was three balls on the break. So
three.
Yeah, pretty powerful. Three balls on the break and shot on the one. That's more than you can hope for.
Pretty shot.
Mm-hmm. Didn't really want to fall perfectly straight.
Exactly. And if he draws it. He draws it back, he could play the combo on the 8, maybe.
Right. But the 8's 8 inches out of the pocket.
It's dead straight. I mean, maybe a quarter of an inch further off the rail with the cue ball. So technically there is a slight angle, but...
Yeah, this is very treacherous.
Yeah, he's looking at that combo on the 5-8.
We're going to see some good shot making now.
Wobble this ball.
That's a nice solid stroke there.
He took what he got there. That's sometimes you can't do anything special. You just got to take what you get.
well stated, Jeff. You have to take what the table's willing to give you. You're not going to wrestle with this table and force it to do something it doesn't want to, because these tables are unforgiving.
I mean, you made it hard enough drawing the ball back anyway, so.
Mm-hmm.
This is not an easy shot.
No, very tough.
And of course, he's not getting on the seven with this shot. He's got to remember that he's, you know, I'm sure he knows, I don't have to tell him. It's the five ball is his next shot. So that's what the amateur forgets a lot of times. They play a combo and then go, oh my God, I haven't got a shot on the whatever the first ball was.
Oh, position on the secondary object ball is extremely difficult, because even if you hit the eight ball on the wrong side, the five can easily lodge up along the side of the cushion to make it much more complex.
And they do that so well, the pros. I mean, they have it down. They know exactly where the ball's going afterwards. And he might opt for a safe here. He might not even take this on. He's taking a lot of time over it. I don't know whether, I doubt whether the shot clock has been brought in on this table, but there is a shot clock rule that if they do get a little bit behind on the tally of, oh, it went. Well, after all that deliberation, that's.
He had half a pocket, and that's what we couldn't tell from
why
here.
That's why he was taking so long. It was obviously not a full pocket, right?
Right, right.
And he got perfect on the seven. Anywhere in the middle of the table. Don't go behind the nine. Well, I think his girlfriend Angie could run these out, so.
Well, no.
Careful. You've got to be kidding me.
You've almost jinxed him. About one more statement like that, Angie could run this out left-handed.
She plays good, actually. I was in Vegas playing with her, and she's like, wow, didn't realize she was that good.
Huh.
She's his understudy. They bring her in when he's not feeling too good. Where is she? She's sitting somewhere. Yeah. She's sitting over in the corner. This is not what he wanted. He didn't want to be having to come back off that other rail like this. See? And he's hooked him. You've got to be kidding me.
Well, you pretty much did it to me in there when you mentioned Angie.
Well, let's hope he doesn't listen to the playback of this.
Yeah. Let's hope he didn't hear it. I feel sorry for you after this match.
Yeah, with those boxing skills. I think you forget boxing skills after a while, don't you? Hopefully.
I don't think so. The problem for you is when you face a guy that has no fear of getting hit, that's bad for you.
The Rocky Marciano.
Yeah.
Just stands there and takes it.
Phil's looking at a half-mast, eh?
Yeah, this is not. Can you believe that? That he basically screwed up and left him no shot. That's. Sickening.
Phil's absolutely just delighted to get back to the table in this game. Yep.
Wow. Can you believe that?
Well, we just saw it. I don't believe it.
That's Paul. That's Paul. Now, that one definitely is key at the end of this match, because what was that? 2-2, was it? Or three,
it would have been 3-3.
Yeah, would have brought it back level, and now he's jumped ahead two games.
It's now 4-2.
Well, I can guarantee one thing. Appleton will not be banging his stick into the floor when he goes back to his chair.
No. A little bit of a sluggish start here in the match.
Yeah.
Both players exhibiting, you know, precision skills. The best played game so far was the safety, the defensive game that happened last rack.
Well, Phil wants to get back here. He's got his two buttons undone on his shirt because the collars, they're not used to having collars rubbing their necks, and they're all complaining about the collars rubbing their neck.
Yeah, crushed him, but
nothing.
Not blessed with the ball going in. It's always tough to tell what the angle is, but it does not look to be easy to cut this one ball back into the side pocket. But
he might play safe here and try and put it over in the corner by the seven, see where he looks.
Well, when you're an offensive ball-making machine like Darren Appleton, safety is the last resort. He oftentimes likes to default towards shooting because he is so accurate and he can shoot his way out of a lot of circumstances.
Yep. Yeah, making those hard shots up the rail and stuff just to get back into a rack is, they're the key ones. That's,
and when you're playing another player that possesses dynamic firepower, that's your best defense, is to just run some racks.
Well, it gets to the other guy's head as well when you pull off a fantastic shot to finish off the rack.
Overcut it.
See, and it would have been an easy shot to put it behind the 7 because that's exactly the direction he went anyway, if he'd have just hit it softer pace. But he really hasn't left Phil much of a shot here. It's a scratch in the side if he plays it up this end.
No, it's beyond the side pocket enough that the scratch won't be there.
Is it? Follow? Yeah, okay.
But the thing is, you're shooting to nothing. You know, there's the 2-ball doesn't go past the 7, right. So that further complicates matters. So we're looking at a safety play here. And an off-angle, long-range. Oh, he's looking at cutting it. He looks like he wants to take on the 1-ball down the
Well, maybe he's
pocket.
Thinking he can get it off the cushion and get it to come off the 6 and go back downtown a little bit. I'm not sure what he's trying to do.
Well, I think it's a position to either play a pre-planned safety on the 2, you know, just a stop shot, park the cue ball. If he's going to pocket the 1, then he's going to have to play safe on the 2. He's going to play cross-side bank on the 2. See how he put a little left English to get back there? That's interesting.
He's put it back where it was. The cue ball, the 1-ball's probably in about the same place it was before, not far off.
Right. Sometimes the matches, you know, you just have to win ugly. The balls are kind of conspiring against both players from denying them a run-out game right now.
I think he's going to put the cue ball down the bottom rail here.
Clearly not
at that speed.
Clearly playing a safety. Well designed.
Oh, that's a good save.
It certainly is.
Even though he's not locked on that 5, that's cut down a lot of options putting it behind that 5.
Well, shoot past it appears and just grazes the 1-ball. So, once again, our angle does not give us a fair view of it, but we can tell by the way he's lined up.
But Darren Appleton is in the driver's seat. Almost. I think he may be able to see the edge of it, I'm sure.
It's interesting how the upper hand changes in safety battles.
Yeah. Well, if that had come right, just roll right around behind that 10, that would have been a great safety.
If Darren can hit the edge of the 1-ball directly, he has the upper hand. If he has to kick at this, Phil will have the upper hand. He did have to kick rail first, so Phil does have the upper hand.
Phil can make this after he's moved the magic rack.
I don't think he's going to want to make this. This is going to be another safety shot.